Welcome to Raging Bullets, our DC Comics fan podcast, episode 700, part 2. We do a Batman 66 watch-along.
From the sleepy suburbs of Cleveland, Ohio, there are assembled the world's two greatest podcast hosts, created from the cosmic legends of the universe. Sean Whalen.
Welcome to Raging Bullets, a DC Comics fan podcast. I'm a big fan of variant covers. My love for Batman is that stuff. Let's talk some comics.
And Jim Seculin.
How's it going, eh? You know me and Superman, I'm really loving what they're doing. Raging Bullets is a spoiler podcast.
Their mission? To discuss DC comics in books, movies, and television several times a month in 1 to 3 hour episodes. And to serve all mankind.
Outstanding.
Welcome to Raging Bullets. I'm Sean Whalen, Dr. Norge, and I'm joined as always by my co-host Jim, the sensei of the whatnot, the duke of, you know, the salt of strategery, the bridge-defying holy hole in a donut. We have done over 700 shows, and he remains the elder statesman of the podcast, Seculin.
How's it going, eh?
Jim, on this episode, we're going to be doing a Batman 66 watch-along, and just a little disclaimer on this. Because we're syncing up to a movie, there's some points in time where, because we're watching the movie in front of us, there's some pauses. Not a lot. Jim and I are usually pretty good. One of us is jumping on when the other is silent. But sometimes there's something in the film that we're watching that is leading to a thought that, like, we both, like, watch really quick and then jump on from there. So just a little quick disclaimer about that. We are sponsored, as always, by DCB Service and InStockTrades.com. Mr. Seglin, what is going on over at DCBService.com?
They always talk about the great deals they have on comics, and they do have some really cool deals. But remember, they've got statues, figures, apparel, and whatnot. But right now, I'm looking at HeroClix. But they're not just HeroClix. They're specialized ones. We've got the HeroClix iconic Nightfall scene of Bane breaking the bat. 25% off, $22.49. Plus, we've got a really cool Batman and Robin. They took that funny meme out there of Batman slapping Robin and made it into a hero clip. So, 25% off, $14.99. Thank you, DCBS.
Also sponsoring us is InStockTrades.com. This is where I really love them. They've got that Batman One Bad Day box set, the direct market edition. $44.99 regularly, 50% off only $22.49. This is a great way to get those books if you missed out on them. Batman, the 1989 movie adaptations trade paperback. This is Denny O'Neil and Jerry Ordway. $14.99 regularly, 50% off only $7.49. The Unwritten Compendium trade paperback. This is Mike Carey and Peter Gross from, they're labeling it DC Black Label now. It was before Vertigo. This is a $60 book, 50% off, only $29.99. And this is a great, The Unwritten is, did you ever read The Unwritten?
I don't think so.
Terrific story. And so these are books that I'm recommending that are all really, really good. I want to thank DCB Service and InStockTrades.com for continuing to support our show. Jim, on that note, what kind of a podcast are we? Because we're talking about something really different.
Holy, exciting movie we're about to watch, Dr. Norge. Raging Bullets is a spoiler podcast. We are going in depth into plot lines, story twists, and whatnot of Batman 66. So if you haven't watched the movie, please do yourself a favor. Stop, watch the movie, come back along with us. That way you can better enjoy the show.
On that note, let's watch Batman 66 together. So, Jim, we're going to be in a few seconds kicking off, or a few minutes, kicking off our Batman 66, the movie discussion. I was shocked that we haven't done this on the show. I know we've talked about it, and we've talked about Batman 66 quite organically. I don't think we've really watched along or talked about anything. I'm looking now, I don't think we've done that for Batman 66 at all. So when you suggested this as something for our 700th show, absolutely we need to do this, because foundationally, we wouldn't be doing this if it wasn't for Batman 66. And the truth of the matter is that was the childhood piece that kicked me off into my rabid fandom that caused me to reach out to you in the beginning of when we were going to start this podcast to want to do more. If this didn't exist, that wouldn't be a thing. But it was really the TV show. I remember watching the movie when I was young, but certainly the TV show was a lot more prominent for me. I don't remember when I actually watched the Batman 66 movie. It was when I was young the first time, but I was so young, I think it was just felt like a big episode versus the fact that it was a movie and everything associated with it. What was your experience with this? When do you know when you first saw it? Because I really can't pin that down other than I was watching in the 70s the Batman 66 show, and it was more when I came home from school, you'd get a couple episodes and get to enjoy it. What was your experience?
Well, first off, the idea to do 66 as a watch-along does come from my brother Bill. Got to give him full credit on that. He threw that out there saying, hey, have you guys talked about that? Like, I don't know if we have or not. So full credit. So thank you, Bill. And it was funny because I was with a lot of like the different shows and all that. I remember in past episodes I've said, I watched it sporadically and all that. Bill, again, reminded me. He's like, no, we watched that religiously, all of them. You know, the Shazam, all of that. So, like, with me not remembering very little on Shazam, we watched every one of those episodes. And every one of the 66 TV show, we religiously watched that. And I was like, I don't remember watching it that intently or that. And Bill's like, oh, no, we 100%. It was him, my brother Dave, and me. We all were always glued to the TV when it was on. So, you know, and again, I don't remember that as much. So it was kind of neat that Bill told me that. So we probably saw the movie. I don't remember watching the movie as a kid. I remember watching it after we started doing the podcast, because I had it on, I owned it on the iTunes. So that wouldn't even be in the beginning of the podcast, and probably be middle of the show, middle of the podcast is when I, really would have bought it, because, I wasn't buying anything through the computer when we first started doing this, and it wasn't until later on when I actually got my Mac and came back to doing Macs again is when I really started buying stuff through iTunes and whatnot. I don't remember watching it as a child. I did watch it as a child, but I don't remember it at all. I watched it probably maybe 10 years ago, and it was funny even watching it this time, those stuff I forgot about.
Yeah.
Like, I completely forgot that it was Lee Merriweather who was Catwoman. I thought it was, in my head, I was always thinking Julie Newmar was the Catwoman in the movie.
And she couldn't do it for some reason, she was had another obligation. There was some reason why she couldn't do it, and that's why Leah Merriweather was the one off in this one.
Yeah, and that was the thing that kind of first really threw me when I was watching it. And there's little stuff that I 100% remember the scene, when I was rewatching it. But there was a bunch of stuff that I completely forgot about. I'm like, oh my god, that is awesome! I forgot about that.
And this was the height of Batmania, when. This movie came out. So it's really, it's a big deal to watch it and understand why this TV show wound up being a movie, because they were just cashing in and on the craze. And I don't say cashing in a bad way. Hey, people wanted more.
Yeah.
And you get an opportunity to do that and make, and obviously clearly to make money off of something, you're going to do it.
Well, it's funny because, I watched it again last night. And I was just going to sit up on my computer, and watch on my computer. And Dad's like, hey, why don't you watch it down here? So I was like, okay. So I watched on the big screen down there. And he sat there and watched it with me. There was a couple stuff he chuckled at, a couple stuff I could see. He's like, okay, whatever. But, it was kind of neat that Dad actually sat and watched it with me.
I've got a signed photo of Adam West from him. It's him holding the bomb.
Oh, nice.
And it says, to Sean, Adam West. He was at a comic convention. And it was, they only did two of them. In Ohio, somebody had won a lottery here, and they did a comic convention. They brought in a lot of celebrities for it. Boba Fett was here, Adam West, Julie Newmar, Peter Mayhew was here. It was quite the cast of characters that was there. And I'm underselling it by the names I'm throwing out right now, because there was a lot more there than what I'm talking about. But that was my first chance to meet Adam West. And that was before they were doing, getting pictures taken was a big thing at conventions. At least here. It was before that was, kind of a thing. Then I had another opportunity. And at that same convention, I met Yvonne Craig, who was Batgirl.
Yeah.
So I've got a signed picture of Batgirl. So I got to meet both of them. I got to meet Julie Newmar. It was cool. I've got a picture of you and I, a 5x7 in a replica of the Batmobile.
Yeah, I remember that one.
Which was cool. And in that same wall, I've got a picture of myself with Adam West and Burt Ward from a convention here. And it was, I think it was Wizard World. Really cool to have met both of them. It's a childhood dream, right? It was on my bucket list, like Stan Lee, to be able to meet them. Actually, this is not downplaying Stan Lee, because of the impact of that Batman 66 show on my childhood. The real getting to get a picture with Adam West and Burt Ward was like the holy grail, and something I would have never dreamt as a child I would ever be able to really do. So that part was really cool. This movie, the movie, the whole Batmania thing, has just a important role in my love of comics and things like that. I did not know that it was a parody. And as a kid, I took all of this very seriously. I was all for being a crime fighter. And as a kid, the cool part was, even though they were doing, you know, some parody stuff, Batman was trying to teach you to just be a good person overall in it. And that's how, at least that's how I took it when I was watching the show as a kid. It was a pivotal impact of that Batman. And as I grew, it was funny, as you got into comics, the comics were a little bit more serious than the TV show was. And then they got, you know, Super Friends was out there. Then the comics in the 80s got really serious. Yeah. And I was like, oh, this is awesome. It was like almost like this character, my understanding of this character grew as I was growing. And this, though, was just a pivotal series. And I'm really glad we're getting a chance to talk about this. So why don't we cue this up and we'll chat more specifically about this movie.
To the Batmobile. Let's go. Atomic batteries to power. Turbines to speed.
You're ready to move up.
Jim and I right now are at all zeros, right before the 20th Century Fox logo hits. So we're actually seeing a black screen. It hasn't kicked into that yet. I'm going to do a countdown. So it's going to be 3, 2, 1. Then on the word go, we're going to all hit start. All right? Ready, Jim?
Ready.
3, 2, 1, go. And the logo just popped up. 20th Century Fox. I love seeing that old logo. There's something about that that's just classic. It just takes me back to my childhood. This was interesting. All these acknowledgments. Yeah, I did too. So,
you know, and that's kind of neat. Just again, a little, you know, adding to the camp factor, a little bit of the cheese factor, but also kind of a breaking down the fourth wall long before anybody else did this. A message, a letter, you know, a letter of love from the directors and whatnot to the people. So that's kind of funny.
The one piece that wasn't cheese, though, they actually were acknowledging crime fighters of the world.
Yes,
which I thought was really cool. You know, so while we're having a little fun here, we actually are being really, you know, I think just, I always liked the idea of the fact they were acknowledging the police.
And they did that throughout the series. And it's one of the things that I completely forgot about them doing in the series is the life lessons and the, I don't want to say the moral code, but it's, you know, just trying to have, trying to steer people on the right path. And I like that. So there was something I, watching it this time, I'm like, oh yeah, they kept doing that in the TV series. I forgot all about that.
Adam West had a certain swagger about him that just like is endlessly appealing. I noticed more this time, Cesar Romero, the Joker's mustache.
Yeah, his mustache, yeah.
Especially, you know, in the backstory. As a kid, I didn't notice it at all. I don't know why, but it was there. I mean, and it's not, it wasn't like, I mean, certain it was hidden to a certain extent, but I certainly didn't remember that being something that I was like noticing as a child.
And that came about because Cesar Romero refused to shave his mustache.
Yeah.
because he's famous. He's the famous Latin lover, and he needed, you know, he wanted to keep his, you know, his grooviness, you know? So I was like, you know, and again, it's something that you learn later on. You're like, oh, that's kind of funny.
It certainly didn't take away from anything, the fact that he had the mustache.
It fit. And again, you know, his portrayal of Joker is one of that, you know, people do parody, you know, to this day. Same thing like with Penguin and Riddler and throw Catwoman as well. These are a lot of people will base their interpretation of the characters on these rogues. And I like that.
They did a pretty good job with this, with the fact, I mean, it's a movie as opposed to, you know, these half hour TV shows. And, you know, there was something like this opening with the yacht was just a really cool sequence. They made this cook. I mean, it's really important that this kept moving along. I got to go to the Wayne Manor from the outside fence in California. I mean, the house looks just like this from the outside.
Yeah. And it's one of the things I really appreciated about this time was the stunt work.
Oh, yeah.
You know, because they don't have CGI. They don't have anything really too fancy. And there's the times you can tell they're on a set and it's no longer anything dangerous. But the stunt crew for Batman and Robin must have had fun doing
this. The instant costume change lever. Yeah. I don't know that I ever remembered that.
All the labels, I never remembered seeing those as a kid. Yeah. But as an adult, I completely noticed them.
This moves quick though, right away, right to the Batmobile, which at the time, like, super cool that they jump into this. Yes. And it's funny how the use of vehicles in this and even sets, some of them in this are specifically like, we're just throwing in the Batmobile because we can here, but we're really like jumping to the next thing. They're going to the airport just to jump into the Batcopter. And even that, I'm questioning, like, did we need this in this beginning scene? No, they just did this because it's cool. And it is.
And I liked, it was funny because I liked how Batman kept his Batcopter at the airport, not in a secret compartment on Stately Wayne Manor like the current run, you know, Bat does. Now, granted, this Batman is a deputy of law enforcement and whatnot, so they do a little differently. But it, for me, it was kind of neat how they had to keep their special vehicles away from Wayne Manor.
Here's where I disagree with you, but in a strange way. How easy would it be for the Joker and the Penguin and the Riddler to sabotage that doggone thing?
Big time. 100%. Yeah, so that's the weakness to it, but I kind of liked it.
Oh, yeah. I liked everything about this, so I'm agreeing with you, and that's why I said I'm sort of disagreeing with you.
Yeah.
This is great, though, because this is such an era where, like, Batman's just, like, waving to the crowd. He's a celebrity. Yeah. I mean, this is not our Batman today.
And, of course, law enforcement, head over their heart, and it's funny because Robin waves to the girls, Batman gives a thumbs up to the cops.
Gives a feller a good feeling to know they're up there doing their job. Such a cool sequence.
Yeah, some of the Robin stuntmen, you can clearly see it's not Burt Ward.
The convention I was referencing, they actually had a replica of this, a guy had built. And, it looked identical. We've got a picture by it. It looked really, really cool. I like that everything's got a bat gadget.
Yes.
I didn't remember that this sequence was so early in the film. Like, I remember this sequence, and I was, like, thinking to myself, like, did they really do this here?
Yeah, that did throw me, too. Because I remember the scene, and I remember, coming up with the shark and everything, all that stuff. But I didn't remember it this early.
And it was iconic. It was just appeared in the comics recently.
In Bat Letter. It's got label. Everything's got a label on it. Oh,
here's the thing. I love this. Bat ladder?
100% love it now. And I'll be honest with you, as a kid, I don't remember noticing it.
Mm-hmm.
I think I remember Batman being a little bit goofy when I was watching it as a kid. But I'll be honest, I don't remember that. I don't, because again, Brother Bill and I talked about it. He's like, we were all 100% all in on this.
Yeah.
We didn't think it was campy back then. You know, and I was like, because he remembers better than I do, because he is much older than I am. So he was older when we watched this.
Here's the thing. I don't know. I think I don't remember every label that was there, but I think some of the reason why is I just expected it.
Yeah.
Like, this was the way this Batman operated. So everything was there was a bat ladder. There was a bat this and a bat that. Here's the they could sell me anything as a kid saying it was a bat something, and I'm all in on it.
Oh, big time. Oh, 100%. And again, as I said, the stuntmen must have loved this scene.
Yeah.
You know, and you'd think it'd be something easy to climb down a ladder, but it's not, especially hanging from a helicopter. They've got crosswinds. They've got all types of crazy stuff going on. So I can imagine the stunt crew was like, oh, this is going to be a fun day.
Oh, yeah. And it was great how he was, you know, saying, lower, Robin, lower. Robin screws up here.
Yeah, a little bit.
Because, I mean, he not only did he get him low, but...
Oh, yeah, I'm too low.
Yeah.
Holy sardine.
I love that this isn't just like some random shark, that this is somehow a clue to the villains of this movie.
Yes. Well, and it's a, you know, and of course, you know, the famous, you know, shark repellent, bat spray, you know.
This is one of my favorite sequences. And it's funny how like watching this now is just different. Because as a kid, admittedly, and I love this still, so many fond memories. But there's points, like, he's climbing down and could have just handed it to him. I love where this goes. He's climbing down, but has to remind everyone that he's a little bit more acrobatic.
Yes.
So he does this thing where he, like, is hanging upside down. I'm trying to figure out why he had to do that. And, like...
Okay, I'll answer that one.
Okay.
He couldn't just drop the bat spray down to him.
Mm-hmm.
And he couldn't climb all the way down. He had to get it so that, because if his feet were in the way, he couldn't really pass it. So he's got to get a clean pass off, you know, which is, you know, him dangling by his feet to pass it down to him. Mm-hmm. So I agree with that.
I don't, because it took so long. Why does Batman still have his leg?
Well, hey, it's Batman. He's okay.
The spray thing is so crazy. And then how did it explode?
Well, they explain that later on.
I know they did.
With TNT. So, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, so funny. I love Chief O'Hara in this one. He's like, you're lucky that the Dynamic Duma even talked to you at all.
Yeah. You know, and it's interesting seeing, you know, Batman lie. He's very cool and straightforward. And you can see the nervousness in Burt Ward. I like that Robin wasn't as easy with the manipulation, you know, or actually he's doing it to because he didn't want to incur panic. But I did like, a little bit of acting done there, you know, and it's not something I would ever have thought, oh, there's going to be some really good, solid acting in this. I like Burt Ward's nervousness and, kind of when he was dealing with that.
I like how Batman's whole demeanor changes when it's Kitka from the Mask of Evil. He's totally captivated by her, which, again, goes to his... How does he not know that this is Catwoman? With all of his dealings with her.
He's got a type, and he's, you know, it's smitten, you know? It's kind of like the how did Lois Lane not notice that Superman, you know, and Clark Kent are the same person, you know? You're kind of blinded when you get when the googly eyes start happening.
But I like this explanation about if we remove our mask. I mean, it was cool. It was actually cool the way he handled it. I did in this era. See, this is a funny thing. Commissioner Gordon and Chief O'Hara having their backs, and this being such a team thing. I loved this. Like my whole childhood was growing up and just believing that these, like Batman and Commissioner Gordon, were absolutely the best of friends.
And I like this sequence where. They are deputized agents of the law.
Yeah.
You know, and support your peace. Support your police. That's our message. You know, throughout this, they keep bringing that up. And it was something that, as a kid, I never noticed it. As an adult, when I rewatched it, you really didn't, you know, it's something that didn't really click. But again, I'm sitting here and it's something I'm remembering now. Going, oh, yeah, they always did that kind of stuff.
Well, I like that Kitka was asking the questions that basically everyone would be asking in this one. You know,
yes.
Like, why, you know, why do you do this?
And it makes sense that she would not know, being the Russian. And I love how Batman defended her, saying, hey, this is, she's new to us. She's new to this. Let's not be mean. You know, once again, Batman not being mean to a person who, just because they don't know.
I will flip the switch and check this out. I love that they've got this screen in the room, the closed circuit TV screen, so that way they can see what criminals are currently at large.
Yeah, all of them. Yeah. You're doing a bad job, Bat.
Penguin. Burgess Meredith was awesome as him. He really, really was.
He must have had a ball playing that character.
Obviously the Joker. Devilish clown prince of crime. The Riddler. Frank Gorshin was really, really good as, yes, the Riddler. Lee Merriweather did do a good job in this as Catwoman. Really did.
Yes.
I mean, it's all three women who've played Catwoman in relation to this particular Adam West era all did a great job.
Yeah, it's, I don't remember ever seeing Eartha Kitt as Catwoman, to be honest with you. I don't,
really,
remember those episodes.
Okay. Yeah, she was great.
Yeah, I remember Julie Newmar.
What's happened at the C? C for Catwoman. Yet an
wrong letter.
Yeah. Yet an exploding shark pulling my leg. The Joker. Adds up to a sinister Riddler. The Riddler. Oh, no.
A thought strikes me. It is so dreadful I scarce dare give it utterance. Yes, Commissioner.
I love the insanity of how they put this all together.
Yes. Well, and like later on with the riddles, those always crack me up because there's no way they don't make any sense. But once he says the answer, I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, I should have seen that.
But playing it straight is where it's funny, you know, that's really where it works.
I wonder if there's bloopers on this anywhere out there, because there must have been a bunch of bloopers where they're just cracked up laughing.
Yeah, I don't know how much of that they kept on,
yeah,
on film. I don't know.
You know, present day, they always keep that stuff. But
right.
Back then, maybe not.
Yeah, I can imagine they were pretty protective. I mean, and here's the thing. What would be the outlet for it? You know, every so often, you'll see some stuff like behind-the-scenes stuff on, as far as filming and screen tests and stuff like that. Early stuff with Burt Ward in particular. But you know, it's that's still few and far between. Ahoy, Catwoman.
Yeah.
Never use my real... I like that's her real name. Catwoman.
Catwoman, yeah. Do they ever call her Selina Kyle?
No, I don't... maybe in the show? I don't remember. Boy, you're asking a great question now. I don't remember that. Catwoman is what I remember being called more than anything else. I remember her having aliases. But I don't remember... I don't know that I remember Selina Kyle. I don't know that they didn't, though. I have to really go back and watch.
Yeah.
The effects were actually... I mean, the fact that they did the shocking effects for the Jokers, that actually were pretty good.
Again, yeah. For when this was done, I liked that.
Yeah.
You know, and it's something that, you know, granted, not the greatest by comparison to what we're used to, but for 1966, it looks pretty cool.
And the tone, like, and the tone of this.
Yeah. You know, and again, just each of them having their own little monologues, having their own little personality. Again, they have their own shelves that's marked, you know. But I liked how they gave each of the villains their chance to do their thing. You know, it was kind of a neat usage of a team dynamic. Each one of them had plenty of screen time, had plenty of time to express why they belong here. It's kind of neat in this movie that I didn't think I'd be looking at the quality of the writing and the quality of the acting. I never thought I would be looking at it like that. But I was like, you know, this is kind of neat.
It's the thing that they really did successful in this, though, is the writing. Because...
Yeah.
Your shorter shows are relying heavily on you know, I don't want to say simple premises. You're relying on a two-part premise, you know, with the idea of each episode leading you to a cliffhanger that then is resolved the next episode. So there's a formula that's there. You can't use that formula here in the same way. It has cliffhangers of sorts, but, I mean, they've got to immediately lead into the next thing. And they did a very good job of keeping this. I love this whole thing with Commodore Schmedley, who doesn't know about the Joker or who he is. He's got that ghostly pallor due to the air.
Yeah. And he's been stuck in, fog bound off the Grand Banks, you know, for this whole time.
Commodore Schmedlab. He actually has it the best. He gets like a ringside seat to all this nonsense without like really being ever in any danger. Because they seem to have no intention to hurt this man.
Which, yeah, again, you go back to our current Joker and all them, he'd be dead. Mm-hmm. You know? Any one of the three would have killed the Commodore.
Yes.
But they don't need to. And again, one of the things I liked was, you know, the one sailor with the flipper in the water to give it that splashing sound. I was like, oh, that is cool. Wait,
all that to make Commodore Schmedlap think he's like at sea on a yacht, not not where he actually is. On dry land,
right?
So great.
Now, one of the things I did like about this especially was that the villains kept trying to take out Batman and Robin.
Yeah.
It wasn't we failed, we give up. No, they kept going and they kept going, you know, and plan A didn't work, plan B didn't work, go plan C. They kept doing that. And I think, again, that was something I didn't remember, all the multiple attempts on the Batman's life, you know, Batman and Robin's life in this movie.
The super developing tank?
Yep.
With the bat camera?
And, of course, the magnifying lens, but again, we're seeing a Batman that is a detective here.
Yep.
I like that. You know, and that's something I also don't completely remember from being a thing.
Oh, I do.
In the 66.
Here's where I remember it. That was the whole thing behind the Batcave. The Batcave is where they'd come back to analyze things. They would do this. So this is totally, and I'm not saying you're wrong for not remembering it. I'm saying I vividly remember these sequences from the TV show. They'd come back here and investigate clues. Kind of like this buoy.
Yeah.
And that was something that there's something about that Batcave that I will always just have these just amazingly fond memories of.
Yes. Oh, big time. Now, that's something where if they recreated that set somewhere, I would want to get my picture taken on the Batcave.
Oh, yeah. I'd rather go play in it.
Well, that too, but I don't think if they recreated it, I don't think they'd let people play in it. They maybe would let you take a picture in it, but not run around and, you know.
I didn't say let me do it. I just said I wanted to.
Oh. Well, it was funny. I'm not a big car guy, as you know. But part of me would like to own the Batmobile and have it be functionally street, able. You know, and actually
is it
have
not?
A real car that I could drive down the street.
Is it not? Like, I mean, these kits that people have been making, is it not? I'm asking a genuine question.
I don't know. I don't know at all. I think you can make a street, a street legal Batmobile.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know for certain. Part of me would like to have that, because I think it'd be kind of neat just to,
What's not street legal about it, I guess is my question.
Well, there's all types of legalities with lighting and, I'll be honest, there's a bunch of, depending on what state you live in, mm-hmm. there's certain things a car has to have to be allowed to be on the street. You know, certain safety precautions and whatnot, and so I don't know if the Batmobile would actually have it.
I guess I'm looking at it and wondering what's, aside from its visual look and the fact that it's got some accessories, what makes it different from my car? I don't know that much does. The tops of my Jeep comes off. I can drive that on the road, so nothing about that design does it. I guess I'm just wondering. It's not me disputing you. I'm just you're bringing up something that I'm just finding curious. I'm wondering why that vehicle wouldn't be street legal.
And to be honest, it could maybe be. I don't know. But I know there's a lot of different laws, especially different states have different setups where you have to have certain safety features on your vehicle. And a lot of it's involving lighting and proper lighting, turn signals, that kind of, whatnot that you would need to have.
I guess the lights that are on it, I guess, is the reason why I'm questioning that. It seems to have all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Seems to, at least. So this was created for the movie. They did use it in the TV series afterwards, the boat I'm talking about.
Yeah.
So I was trying to remember, did that actually make it to the TV series? I remember vividly loving the fact that we got a bat boat, that we got a bat copter, the use of the bat cycle in this. We'll talk about that one, because that one's real interesting. Because I mentioned the criticism before of, like, keeping that at the airport, the fact that, and this, the bat boat is just kind of hanging out there. Like, it's not really hidden or anything. You just climb down, and there's the bat boat.
Yeah, they didn't completely think that one through. But that's okay.
This buoy bit is fun.
Yes. And you can clearly tell they're no longer out to sea, and it's a set.
What?
But, oh, yeah.
I'm kidding. Okay.
But, again, it didn't take me away from it. It didn't make me go, I didn't lose anything.
So this was
just because of the show and because of the era and whatnot. I'm like, I like this. I thought they did a really good job with it.
I like actually because I'm walking in knowing the tone of this. I actually really love everything about this. The key is you got to know this is a parody. If you walk into this thinking you're getting like serious, like today's Batman, you're not going to dig this at all because it's not that.
Yeah.
It's got a good story. The story is really good.
You know what? It's got a good, solid story. And mm-hmm. this is something that they could even retell modern. They'd have to modernize it, but they could very easily retell, the crooks working together. And just everything that they did here, just decamping it, de-parodying it, would actually be a solid, bad story.
Couldn't find the fingerprints, but they're finding that tricky Mirage projector.
And again.
You know this is like setting them up, too.
Yes. It was funny. I didn't remember the upcoming sequence when they get stuck to the buoy, but I was thinking the whole time going, why aren't they firing the torpedoes? Fire the torpedoes. Come on. What are you waiting for? And even, Joker and Riddler are like, come on, let's fire, come on, you crazy bird, fire them off quickly.
This piece is great, though, that he's got the penguin, the remote control, everyone's got their own stuff, the remote controlled penguin magnet.
Yes.
It's not the remote control magnet, it's the remote controlled penguin magnet.
Yes, they need it.
This was actually kind of smart, though. Think about how many times Batman and Robin have escaped from them. He's like, let's add another layer to this.
When one problem fails, another one, they do another one. These villains did not give up throughout the entire movie. I thought that was something I was like, I didn't remember how many attempts they have, how many times they escape danger in this movie. And again, I like that he couldn't just unbuckle his utility belt because it's magnetically clamped, it's locked down because of the magnet. So he's got to get his transmitter to undo it. And I was like, oh, that is awesome.
Well, the important part is, even if you're thinking, why didn't you just undo it, they explain it.
Yes.
Like, they did do a really good job of trying to keep you playing along.
Yeah. And again, Batman with his devices and gadgets and sending waves out of super energy to disrupt the torpedo, like, that's outstanding. That, again, it's a classic Batman moment.
When was the last time you used super energy? I love this waves of super energy. It's just so great.
Last time I used super energy was keeping me from smacking you in the head. So, there you go.
I just don't like, is, I don't know, like super energy, that's not a thing.
No, it's not. It's not. You know?
But he's sure convinced it is. And not only is he convinced, but he's got these goofballs convinced it is too.
And Penguin knew that it was, Penguin knew that it was super energy, reverse the polarization.
a super energy reverse polarizer. He knew that Batman had one of those gadgets.
Yes.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Penguin's not an idiot. I like that. Again, you know, but here comes a third one.
I actually love that they have a periscope where they all can look at the same time.
Yes. That was a good idea. You know, that way, you know, the batteries are dead. Oh, no. Shut it on Energizer.
It does build this, like, really cool anticipation. Because I remembered some of these sequences. I didn't remember them in the order that they were in. Like, I knew that, like, something was going to happen with this. And I like that we don't see. Like, you hear that the torpedo clearly hit. But the question is, what did it hit?
And, again, building the suspense of, you know, what's going on? And they look, oh, no, the dynamic duo is not there. And then they show the boat riding away. You know, and I remember, you know...
The noble porpoise.
The almost human porpoise. You know? That's right. It was a noble animal that sacrificed itself, you know, to save them.
He gave his life for ours. The Batboat's cool.
That Batboat does look cool. And that's another thing I wouldn't mind owning.
It exists still. They have it in a museum.
Yeah.
I mean, that original one does.
No,
did you ever play Tiddlywinks?
I played Tiddlywinks as a kid, yes.
Yeah.
They do a great job saying, hey, support your police, but they don't do a great job saying that the U.S. Navy is competent.
No, I actually really love this whole exchange.
Well, hold on. I love it, but it did make me crack up that the Navy's like, oh, did we do something wrong?
Right. Well, I like Batman's response back. Which was totally great on this, but he's like, I love that he's looking this up and he's got, it's in a Rolodex that like, it's important that she keeps playing Tiddlywinks while he's saying we disposed of a war surplus submarine yesterday, a pre-atomic model to a chap named P.N. Gwynn. Did he leave
an address?
Yeah. Like they're going to sell. I love Batman. He's like, why would you, if this guy left you no address, why on earth would you sell this to him?
We haven't done anything foolish, have we?
Batman's so great.
Yeah.
Gosh. So the Penguin in command of a pre-atomic submarine. And I like that this has added another sense of danger to this. They really did a good job of keeping ramping this stuff as a story. The Riddler, I love the Riddler using Polaris missiles as a way to distribute riddles.
Yes. And, again, why don't they just shoot the Polaris missiles and, you know, again, well, the modern would shoot the Polaris missiles to kill people. But, again, this is 66, so they don't do that.
The missile, look, it's written something. What does a turkey do when he flies upside down? What weighs 6 ounces sits in a tree? Oh, man.
Yeah, and again, these riddles, man. It does crack me up.
As a kid, I wanted to drive in that passenger seat so bad because I wanted to ride with Batman.
Yes.
It was never that I wanted to drive the Batmobile. I wanted to be in the Batmobile with Batman.
You wanted to be the passenger. Agree. Yeah.
I like that commissioner's office. I always thought that was a cool like office layout.
What does a turkey do when he flies upside down? He gobbles up. What weighs 6 ounces, sits in a tree, and is dangerous? A sparrow with a machine gun.
Yes, of course. I love that is the...
kind of creature would gobble up a bird in a tree? Oh, God, a cat.
How does that lead to a cat?
I don't know. So now, I do love it.
I love that it took all this to get to the fact that we've now confirmed that the four of them are working together.
Yes. That was the point of it. But again, I do like that later on, we do get that dialogue between Riddler and Catwoman about, why do you got to do this? He's like, oh, it's, I've got to do this. It does show the level of insanity that the Riddler has going on.
Oh, yeah, and the other three clearly see it. Penguin even calls him out at one point in time for some silly riddle. He said, don't do another silly riddle.
Yeah.
This actually is a really cool scheme.
Yeah. Take out the security council that is in Gotham City, right, of course.
Now, the question is, how does this lead to them taking over the world, though?
Well, they take the security council, they ransom them out, mm-hmm. and, you know, they get a bunch of money.
Got it.
So how does that lead to taking over the world? I don't know, but it's kind of their plan.
Right. Right. I like that they don't, like, they get along, but don't really get along.
Yeah. And they've got the moments when they know they need to work together. You know, it is a classic rogues gallery kind of thing where they work together until they double cross each other or until, you know, it fits and it makes sense. And again, I love this whole Riddler rant. Now, this is absolutely brilliant, just how he's going through with the plan, which is a, you know, to be honest, a ridiculous plan, but it's so ridiculous that it fits in the show, and they're breaking it down. This is what we're going to do. We'll do this and that. And, you know, I'll be honest with you, as a kid, I 100% would be like, oh, yeah, this is awesome plan. I like it.
The minute the Batman spots her, he will bop her with a bat.
Not as she's disguised as Kit Kat.
The Kit Kat thing actually works for me.
Yes.
Like, because he's already smitten with her, and they've really used that pretty well.
Yeah. And again, I like the usage of, they need to find a millionaire. Who are they going to use? Oh, I know the perfect victim. You know, and it's, again, Bruce Wayne is the perfect victim. But not only just because he's a millionaire, but because he's a head of that disgusting do-gooding Wayne Foundation. So I was like, oh, this, again, makes perfect sense why they would use Bruce as their bait for the Batman.
It is funny when I do look at Cesar Romero and I see the mustache. It, like, stands out now because I just know it's there.
She did a brilliant job as Catwoman, really.
She really did. And it's hard to do when you're taking on a role like this, made so iconic by Julie Newmar.
Right. And this was the only time she did the role, right?
Right. But really, I thought did an amazing job.
Well, I'll be honest, you know, I honestly thought it was Julie Newmar. My memory was Julie Newmar doing this movie. So they did a great job with the casting to take somebody, you know, that people would accept.
I do like their use of Bruce Wayne, where he's got a little bit of swagger. He's not totally incompetent. You know, I mean, there's something to him. You know, and I like that there's a reason, like, he's known. He's known by the commissioner. He's known by others. You know, like, commissioners often referred to him on the show as his good friend, Bruce Wayne.
Yeah. And again, this Bruce Wayne isn't the billionaire playboy. He's the head of the Do-Gooder Foundation. So this Bruce Wayne is a good guy. You know, so it furthers why so many people would know him, so many people would trust him, why the commissioner would trust him, why all the different, you know, people would be all on Bruce Wayne's side.
Yeah, I think they referred to him as a millionaire, billionaire socialite.
Well, he's a millionaire here. He's not a billionaire. And right. Again, it's 66, so millionaire is huge. Right. Present day, you know, you got to be in the billionaire club. you know, or even the Trillionaire Club. You know, the Millionaire Club is, there's a lot of people, you know, present day who are in the Millionaire Club. Back then, it was a rarity. So it's kind of neat.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. I like how she's able to, she's got the Kit Kat persona, but she's able to, like, do the facial expressions that show that she is Catwoman. Like, I think she did a terrific job of that. Her performance really is good.
And again, really cool acting going on in this movie. And I honestly didn't think I would ever be, I would have been saying that. But you get some really cool, you know, acting, you know, facial expressions, mannerism changes, all that kind of stuff. It was kind of impressive. But you know,
a ballpoint banana. How do you get that as a conclusion?
I don't know. People in a hurry, Russians. Now this is the one I don't get it. What does it mean? You combine a banana and a Russian. You know,
I've got it.
A Russian will slip on a banana and break their neck. How'd you get that from
Wait,
that?
He's validating. That means that there's a clear threat to Miss Kitka. Oh, that's funny.
Oh, God, I love that. She must have unwittingly stumbled in the criminal's plot. Not that she is the criminal, no.
This had to be fun to watch back in the day, and I see why it had such popularity, where you didn't know what they were going to say. Like, what riddle now? And how did they connect it? A ballpoint banana? Alfred was good. He was really a good actor. I liked him quite a bit.
Yeah. This is my Alfred, you know. This is the guy who I always think in my head as being Alfred. And this is the voice I hear when I'm reading really good Alfred stuff. You know, because, again, it goes back to childhood. This is the first introduction of Alfred really to me. So it's, you know, and I always, you know, I don't know. You know, and the actor himself actually did a lot of stuff too. I was going through some IMDb and seeing what people have done, what they didn't do, and all that kind of stuff.
Well, he was incredibly talented.
Yeah.
Alan Napier.
Yeah.
Was who Alfred was. And he was really, really good.
Well, actually, to be honest, all of these people were legit actors, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of neat, you know, thinking about these legit actors were in this Batman movie. And again, with them following, I do like the fact that Alfred's the one who's driving, not Robin. You know, like, they never let Robin drive the car. Come on, man.
They really did a good job with, like, setting up locations and clubs and things like that to give you this sense of Bruce Wayne being kind of a playboy, or Gotham having a nightlife, a social life. You know, I mean, there were things to do.
Yeah. These are a nice little fancy club. And, you know, and again, it's a place where I would expect a millionaire to take his date and, the formal wear and all that stuff.
Would you visit this Gotham?
I would 100% visit this Gotham without even hesitation. I would live in this Gotham, you know?
Pretty powerful considering your thoughts about Gotham City in general.
Exactly. You know, I'm all in on, you know, Earth 66 Gotham. You better believe I'm there. 100%.
This whole cart sequence is great because you do get to, you get this idea of why she would be interacting with Bruce. And she's playing him, and he's totally, like, Batman is totally oblivious to this. He really is smitten, which that part I'm not used to seeing.
And completely drops his guard, too.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, 100% full on has him. You know, and again, these sequences between Robin and Alfred. One, I love seeing Alfred with a mask on over and his glasses over it because he needs his glasses to see, but he still has his mask on because he's got to keep his secret identity as well. You know, but having Robin, you know, this whole we got to give them their privacy. You got to give them their privacy. And you know what's going to happen when he does that, but it's still, it fits, it feels good. And yeah, I was like, okay, you know, you want to smack the boy wonder, say, no, don't do that. But you understand why they're doing it. You understand Alfred's logic behind it as well. I like this. I like these sequences.
Yeah, the whole trying to give some privacy thing, I kind of get what they're doing here.
Yeah. And I do like that Robin comes up with the idea to trip on the bat signal. And that, to me, was a really cool thing. And I liked how, you know, when Bruce sees it later on, he's like, very clever. You know, he basically giving Robin a nod, hey, that's a good idea.
I really would hang in this Gotham City. It seems pretty awesome. I don't remember the bat signal being super prominent in the show, and I'm not saying that it wasn't. I just don't remember it. This part is great when you see it.
See, I think I always remember them talking about it, but never really seeing it.
I think just how much they use the bat phone.
Yeah,
I think it's maybe one of the reasons why I don't remember seeing a lot of the bat signal, but that was a great use.
Yeah, and every time she says perfect, she goes that perfect, you know? I'm like, dude, come on, you don't hear that?
And I dream of all the savage Cossacks racing over the steps on their brutal mission.
And Bruce has got other ideas.
It is funny to see him, like, in this. Adam West was a really good actor for this.
Yeah.
He had kind of his own little thing going. He's gotten what William Shatner has. Like, there's definitely something very unique to an Adam West portrayal. You know, when you take it to this, to any of the stuff that he's done leading up to, like, Family Guy and stuff like that, it's that guy has certainly a very unique presence.
He's got a groove. He's got, as you said earlier, he's got a swagger to him. He definitely has that kind of, you know, that charisma, that strut, that confidence, whatever you want, the machismo, you know, if you want to call it that. You know, there was something that in this, I didn't really remember seeing this level of confidence and this level of coolness in Bruce Wayne. I didn't remember that. One of the things I do appreciate about this, and it is the strategy of the bad guys, because they keep going through this. You know, they've got a great lineup here. You've got Catwoman, who's seducing Bruce Wayne, setting up the bait, who's going to be the bat bait, you know. They've got open communication because she's got the little clicker thing going on. I really dig this, you know, and it is, you know, again, even just Catwoman throughout this, you know, throwing on the seduction, throwing on the charms, but it's, you know, it's like waiting for his cocoa to warm up. You know, again, they did a really brilliant job with just keeping it innocent, but also giving us plenty of the kind of moments. That even it gets to Robin and Alfred, like, oh, discretion's the better part of this. I think we should just turn off the camera and all that. I absolutely loved it, man.
All because she knew that they were likely watching. Or something was going on.
Could be that. Could be she's throwing off Bruce Wayne. I don't know what the plan was. But it did work out well. And I do like the fact that, you know, again, it's Robin who's a little uncomfortable with it because he's such a young, innocent kid, you know, and then Alfred's like, I think we got to watch this. And then you go right from that to this really fun scene of these flying umbrellas.
Is the Riddler in a sidecar, umbrella sidecar? Is that what I'm seeing there?
It looks like it, yes. So why doesn't the Riddler get his own? I don't know. Or is he just flying so close?
No, that looks like a sidecar, isn't it?
It looks like a sidecar.
Yeah. She's buying time, which is really great because she knows what's going to happen. And you're right to the strategy of this whole thing. I really liked the way that this story was handling it. I also liked the amount of props in the room. Like, I mean, this really was, it set the stage for the time period, you know, that this was shot in. They really didn't waste a lot of money on sets for this. I mean, you know, didn't, I mean, avoid, you know, using the right kind of money. He almost did. He's almost doing the Batman thing there.
Yes, he almost did.
When he's crossing his arms like that, so totally cool.
Yeah. And I like, she's got a little cat brooch, by the way. I don't know if you caught that. You know, right now, Miss Kitka has got that cat brooch on her thing.
But... Oh, no, I didn't see that. How do you not notice that?
How does he not know? He only has eyes for Miss Kitka. He's blinded. Yeah. You know, he's not being his usual self, and he's getting swept away in the moment.
The world's greatest detective is not very observant.
No.
Usually he's got some kind of, you know, excuse where, like, he knew and he planned for this. But there's none of that going on here.
I do like the fact that he opens up and doesn't hold back.
You can do that when they're stunt doubles. Boy, it really is painfully obvious that they're stunt doubles, too.
Yeah.
I wonder how much of that was superintended in this.
Well, it happens in this era of television and movies and whatnot. Yeah, we don't have a lot of the actors doing all their own stunts.
I'm not knocking it. It was great. I guess what I'm more asking is how much was that intentional? Like, was it intentional that it was so obvious? Because usually they try to hide it. Even then, you know, you can do that with camera work and things like that. I wonder if it was part of the joke.
I don't know. But holy demolition!
Holy Halloween! Yeah. I like that they're scooting away on these umbrellas. The umbrellas were cool.
Yeah.
Batman's got his gadgets. This one had some really cool... I like how she's just kind of enjoying the ride. How do you not notice that? That, like, she was okay with everything.
She was unconscious.
He was unconscious. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Bruce Wayne, a girl companion. You didn't give her a name? Come on, newspaper. She's got a name. Miss Kitka.
I do like their United Underworld kind of
logo.
Yeah. That part was kind of cool. He put his foot here. The secret Jack in the Box.
Yeah. And it sends him through the window to Penguin's exploding octopus. Not just an octopus. It's got to be exploding. Once again, Penguin, what's up with killing all these innocent animals?
I love that nothing's going to link them to the crime, when in the meantime, it seems like everything they do, no matter how ridiculous, links them to the crime.
Yes.
If you have heart... This Bruce Wayne, he's like ready to go all out. He's going to kill them.
Wait, kill
it's like
all.
He jumped right to where everybody's going to be killed. I will rend you limb from limb.
Yeah.
That's so great.
He is a little bit unnerving, you know?
Yeah.
And it was funny, when he went behind the barricade, I was expecting him to do something else, you know?
It's interesting how Bruce Wayne is not, like, totally incompetent. I actually, it's an interesting sort of play on Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
Because you really got to count on him being... who he is. It's interesting.
Now, this sequence with those two together.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I like that. I have no memory of this sequence at all. But I absolutely loved how Bruce plays the bad guys in this one. You know, when he tells her about the transmitter on his arm and this, that, knowing they're listening in. It's a classic Batman stuff. But also, I love the fact that he admits that I was so distracted, you know? Yeah, and almost slips that he's Batman. Her beauty, you know, lulled her off guard. Yeah, almost slips that he's Batman.
He's super great in this, as because the Bruce Wayne piece, they gave him a lot of personality, a lot to do, and I can kind of see why you wouldn't think that he's Batman.
Yeah. Now, part of me wonders, does Catwoman start to have feelings for Wayne? There's moments, you know, when there's a twinkle in her eye, it looks like she may be starting to fall for this guy.
Either that or she plays the game really well.
Yeah. Again, could be that as well. But it's kind of nice to see that, you know. Again, it adds to why Bruce Wayne is so smitten with her, that maybe she's also falling, or maybe she's just that good at hiding it. I don't know. You know, it's kind of neat.
I like that they're all listening. You think he knows that they're listening in?
Yes, I 100% think he knows that. You know, and part of the reason is where he's talking about the that transmitter on his arm.
Yeah.
You know, and they immediately go for it, and he uses that later on to fight them to get away.
That part's really cool.
Yeah.
I do like the depth of this, where there's certain things you can kind of start weighing in on and go, does Bruce Wayne really know? I do like that he is somebody that, like, the police are used to going to.
Yeah.
The villains know who he is because they've had multiple dealings with him. You'd think at some point in time people would question, though, that, like, he gets into these messes and is not afraid. This guy comes in an interesting place.
And I loved how he covered up why he would have that transmitter, because capitalists like him who carry large sums of money often have these things. It's kind of like whenever Bruce, you know, has to do some fighting and he's like, oh, for insurance purposes, I had to learn I had to learn martial arts or something like that. Because this Bruce Wayne, he's not holding anything back. He's throwing down with doing a really good job taking on the Gotham's underworld.
Oh, he sure is.
Yeah. It was curious. I was always wondering if they would ever have how they would handle violence with a Catwoman. And she's always on the sidelines. There's never any physical danger to her.
Ah, I love that. I love that it's one of their crooks that gets sent over to that.
And he goes exploding. And, of course, Bruce goes immediately there to try to find Miss Kitka. You know, and here's where I'm like, why didn't he realize it here? You know, again, he's smitten, he's hit, you know, and he uses this moment to escape. And, again, really cool Bruce Wayne moments for him.
There's a little bit of a James Bond vibe to some of that.
Yeah. Diving off a pier, not safe. That's just me and my diving fears now.
This is where this story's, you know, they're, wait, I love it. I just escaped, but I've got to get going to the fish hatchery. Yes. Like, forget it. No time to decompress. I've got to get to that fish. Come on. We've got to get to that fish hatchery.
Yep. Now, Burt Ward, that was kind of slick, the sliding on the banister.
It was cool.
Yeah. And, of course, the labels on their poles. That's something I always did notice. And the instant
I do not remember the lever, the instant costume change lever.
I don't remember that either.
I remember the poles. I remember them coming down in the costumes. I don't remember that lever.
Yeah.
I like the detail of them going down and using it every time. I wonder how much of this was, like, reused footage. Like, was that the same footage? I don't think it was the same footage from earlier, was it? I don't know.
I would guess it probably was, to be honest with you, because that's one thing they did back then.
Was it the same outfit they were wearing earlier, though? Like, when they first went down the pole. I don't know that it was the same outfit.
Yeah. No, actually, I don't know.
They did it in the show a lot. I'm wondering if they didn't in the movie, because it's a movie. Easier to catch.
Yeah.
The costuming for the villains was really good in all of this.
Oh, God, yeah.
The Riddler's suit, the Joker's, Penguin's, Catwoman's. I mean, they're all good costumes.
Yeah. You know, and I did like whenever Riddler, he kept putting his mask back up and taking it down when he was, you know, and I'm assuming the actor probably hated wearing that mask. You
know? He was a famous comedian at the time, Frank Gorshin.
Yeah. You know, the usage of the improvise, adapt, and overcome that they did in this TV show is awesome. You know, like, you think back, Mr. Freeze's was the fire extinguisher. This is obviously a vacuum.
So how do you, here's the thing. What amount of money is enough when you're a thug like this to say, hey, I'm going to let you dehydrate me so that you can unleash me later?
Well, he does assure him it's painless. And the Penguin wouldn't lie.
I'm going to temporarily extract every bit of moisture from your body. There is not like one of them that's like, hey, I want out on this.
Yeah.
Like when I saw what happened to the first one, if I am the one on the end, like number five, why is he still there? Number five,
I'd be like, no.
Why is he still there?
Hard pass here.
Yeah.
And again, calling them guinea pigs, that in itself should not instill confidence in you if you're the bad guy.
I like that they've got confetti lockers.
Assorted well, those are the confetti. Joker's confetti.
Yeah, yeah. He's very organized.
Yes. You know, and get a dustpan. I mean, you know, you would think they would have it more laid out, a better plan than a dustpan and a little broom.
Tell me some of these sets wouldn't make a great escape room. Like a Batman 66 escape room.
Oh my God, that would be fun.
You know what I mean? With a storyline and everything where you have to like find the... But you could almost make the clues as ridiculous as the ones that they have in this. Like you have to use Batman logic to get out.
Oh God, yeah. That would be fun.
That would be a lot of fun. Wait, at a comic convention, I would pay to participate in a Batman escape room, like a really well done one.
That comic book convention, 100%, you would be, you know, booked from open to close every day.
Because that'd be a fun thing to do with friends. Like even like people listening to this right now, I gladly would get together with a crew of anybody listening right now, and like do something like that. They'd be just a load of fun at a convention, right? Great bonding experience, too. None of us get to see each other very often, you know, or at all, you know, in that case, and being able to get together and have that shared experience of, like, doing that kind of thing. That is where conventions are fun. And conventions are getting a lot more clever with the activities and after-hours parties and things like that that are going on, that I could see that being a big hit. Especially a properly themed Batman one.
Yes. Oh, God, yeah. And it's funny, this is the first usage of the rope climb.
In this?
You know, this late into the movie. I was expecting, you know, that we would have gotten this a lot sooner. You know, and again, it's something else that amazed me on this whole sequence about when they're talking about with the drinking and people, you know, attributing it to alcoholic delusions and just this whole anti-drinking thing that, you know, I'd never remembered anything like that in the actual series.
I always loved these.
Yep.
You're right, honey. There was somebody walking up the wall. How would you jump to that?
Well, if you heard the thump, thump, thump of the footprints, you know, the footsteps. So, yeah.
I like them returning to the scene of the crime.
Well, they're going in there to try to find Miss Kitka.
Yeah, but I'm saying it was a really cool piece. This was a pretty noble Batman thing. He's like away robbing away, and he's taking one for the team.
Yeah.
This really is a good comedy bit.
Yes.
So he's risking his life for Miss Kitka, sees the bomb, recognizes the... I love this.
is getting ready to throw it out the window, and he can't because of all the people down there. Oh, no. That band. I'm like, come on, people.
Now, again, I remember watching this sequence as a kid and thinking how cool Batman was doing all this. Yeah. It watches totally different now.
Oh, God, yeah.
But it's really well done. I love, like, the two ladies in the foreground that are like, hey, listen, this buffet's not going anywhere. Do what you want with that bomb, buddy, but I'm not going anywhere.
Now, here's the funny thing. If those two ladies had gotten up and run, would Batman have left the bomb in the place because he emptied it out, or would he still have needed to run away?
I don't know. They sure didn't
runs,
give
it. Yeah, runs the one way, sees a bunch of nuns. Runs the other way, sees the lady with the baby. Oh, no.
The band's showing no signs of turning around. They're like, I got a dude some running at me with a bomb. It's like, listen, dude, I am all in going this way.
We got the right of way. Marching bands have the right of way. Who's the throw over the one? There's people there. There's people there. Oh, no.
Longest fuse ever.
Yes. Thank God. Thank goodness for the long fuse. Hey, no. People kissing. Ah, dang it.
Butane. Adam West really did a great job.
And again, the nuns, the baby, and the band. Yeah. What the heck? Come on. Are they following him?
This really was a well-produced bit. Yeah. I mean, when you look at comedy bits and the fact that how they kept it going, you feel his frustration. Some days you just can't get rid of a bomb.
Yeah.
It's funny. It's meant to be humor and all that piece. They do set up the suspense and the danger that we don't know off camera what happened to Batman.
Of course, we know, but I liked how they did that.
Yeah. I didn't remember what happened, though. I remember this whole bit. I didn't remember how he escaped.
Yeah, and all he did was just throw the bomb and hide behind some iron pipes.
Yeah. You risk your life to save that riffraff in the bar.
They may be drinkers, but they're also human beings.
Well, here's the thing that I love, that the message here is, like, it's okay to blow up drinkers. Oh, this is great. Yeah. I love this bit where the Penguin is convincing them, listen, I am Commodore Schmedlab, and they know it's the Penguin.
Yep. And the Penguin knows that they know it's him. You know, again, all about the plan. He wants to get into the Batcave. That's the whole plan. He knows he's not going to fool them. Yeah.
But I love that they're trying to say that he's the Penguin. And he's basically, because he's refuting their evidence, they're kind of stuck.
Yep.
Plastic-coated fingertips. Like, what does that matter? What does all this mean? That they just can't arrest him?
Well, that means they can't do the fingerprints. They can't identify him using his fingerprints.
I love that this has put them into this, backed them into this corner where they just can't prove that he's not Commodore Schmedlab.
Yes.
So awesome.
Now, here's where I'm thinking. Bruce knows that Penguin wants to go to the Batcave for some reason. So he's playing along with him.
Mm-hmm. I like how they're all, like, saying you'd be willing to submit yourself to a test. Which, you know, obviously he's up to a scream. I mean, up to a scheme. A scream. He's this man's scheming. Burgess Meredith was great.
Yes. Again, I think they all did brilliant jobs. I do, you know, Burgess Meredith is the one that all the present-day Penguins, they've taken things from him.
Yeah.
You know, you think back, you know, not obviously nowhere near exact stuff with the more recent versions of the Penguin, but they've all taken pieces from Burgess Meredith on this. Just like, you know, all the Jokers have taken pieces away from, you know, Cesar Romero. It's kind of neat that we get that.
Does this ever get too silly for you?
You know what? Now, no. When I was younger, it probably would have. If I had watched this when I was high school, college age, it probably would have been too silly for me. You know, but now I can actually sit back and appreciate what this is and what it's for. And again, I'm recognizing actual acting going on in there. But, you know, teenage version of me would not have picked up on any of that stuff. Now, I do like Penguin's reaction to the Batcave. You know?
Oh, I do too.
You know, again, he's not being character. This is, you know, actual genuine, you know, the Penguin is fascinated by what's in the Batcave.
He's also scoping the place out.
Yeah.
Which is really brilliant.
Yep. Looking for a good spot to release his trap.
Right, exactly. I mean, there's a strategy here that's really, really good.
Again, strategery, it's 100% going on.
Yeah.
And I do like how the sign for the water thing is blocking their vision for all of Penguin to do what he's doing, and how he accidentally flips it over from light water to heavy water.
Yeah, yeah. This really is well done.
Yeah. Oh, big time.
This, we were in high school. This came on TV Land, the TV show. I don't know if the movie ever aired on there, but I remember starting to watch it again on TV Land, and it was fresh eyes. You know, now I knew that the parody was there. You know what it was? It was right around the time of the 89 film.
Yeah.
It was cool to watch this again back then.
See, I 100% did not watch it back then, and I even remember as a kid, remember when 89 Batman came out, I was like, oh, this is so much better than that campy stuff. You know, again, teenage me was a bit of a jerk. You know, he did not appreciate the 66 Batman.
Well, it sounds like your childhood experience with the 66 Batman is very different than mine, though, because, like, you didn't remember watching it religiously. You know what I mean? The same thing so your brother remembered it. So obviously there's just because you watch something over and over again doesn't mean it has the same feel for you that it does for somebody else. You know what I mean? It's a great example of you watch this just as much as I did. Don't remember that you did.
Right.
Which means it didn't have that impact on you as a kid. Do you, here's the thing. Do you like this more now? Like, was this?
Oh, 100%. I love this now.
Yeah.
You know, and I was laughing. I was having a ball watching it last night. I'm having a ball right now watching it again. It's one of those things that sometimes you get caught up in the moment watching this stuff. You know, and again, another brilliant usage of Batman here. You know, because he's trying to convince Commodore Schmedlap, oh, I see, you know, just this whole mind game that he's trained on the Penguin. You were duped. Brainwashed, yeah. Like,
that's the ticket.
Yeah, and it's funny because when I was watching this last night, I 100% did not remember any of these scenes at all.
Right. Another sniff of bat gas, and we'll all return to the city.
Yeah. You know, and again, neat usage of all this stuff. Batman being the master strategist that he is. You know, these are all classic Batman stuff. He's planning for this. He's planning for what the Penguin's going to do. He's getting ready to, you know, it's a trap.
This was great, though, because he knew what was coming.
Yeah. Gave Robin the antidote before anything. Oh, yeah.
I like that Robin knew what they were doing, too. You know, yeah. Like this was well done. This is a great sequence. Because you need to, we've done some bits with Bruce Wayne where Bruce isn't getting caught up by, you know, isn't figuring out about Catwoman. You got to be real careful with overdoing that because this is Batman.
Yes.
So while the campy stuff works, you want to at some point in time at least have us still believing this is the hero of the movie. The hero is, you know, competent to a certain extent. And they really did a good job with this. I like the two immediately pop up and, you know, are now engaging their plan. The anti-penguin gas pill.
Yep. And the bat cycle to the bat copter.
Now, here's a piece I'm questioning. This bat cycle. How? How is that not discovered by somebody?
Well, I think that clever disguise of the greenery.
The shrubbery?
You know, yeah, the shrubbery. And, you know, I don't know. Now, the thing I get is, you know, this sequence with Robin. Here's where I don't want to be Robin riding next to Batman. That looks terrifying. He's just sitting there gripping with a death grip going, oh, my God, I'm going to die.
There were times in this where they didn't use a stuntman for Burt Ward. Yeah. This was clearly one where they did, but I was like sitting there like, wow. Now, the bat cycle is cool, but the only reason why it was in there was to show how they got from where they were left abandoned by the penguin to get to the Batcopter sequence again. And I love that. I love that they were throwing swag at us. They're like, Batman's got some gear. We are going to show you the gear. It is one of the coolest things about Batman is the fact that he has all these toys.
And of course, and again, this is the brilliant sequence. I love how Riddler's got to do it. He's got to throw out his riddles. He's got to do it. It's how it's part of his nature. He can't not do it. It's the classic Riddler thing.
I love that the Joker's trying to reason with him.
Yes.
This is all the more, look what happened with the Penguin. This is all the more reason not to give him those crazy clues.
My joy, my heaven on earth, my paradise. And I love how it almost works.
It did, yeah. Honest,
think about it.
God, how great is this?
Yeah. Firing off the Polaris missile and it hits him. Like, wait, hold on.
Well, this leads to another funny bit where they go crashing. Because I thought they really did some great special effects with this. I got to say, even watch this again, I'm like, how did they get out of this again?
Yeah, again, it was when I was watching going, I don't know what's going on. But the thing that cracks me up is when they do flip inverted.
Mm-hmm.
Helicopter, it's a whatever the physics, I don't know behind it. But helicopters can't fly upside down.
You know? Well, they're not. They're crashing.
Yeah, but, you know, he would not be able to control it once they went inverted.
Well, he isn't, though. They're crashing.
But he does end up controlling it, though. It's a controlled crash.
He told you it was a controlled crash. Like he's telling you that he saw where they landed out of the corner of his eye.
Yes.
That doesn't mean that it's genuine. I'm convinced that this Batman will say anything he needs to say to look like he knows what he's doing.
Yep.
I did like the little attention to detail, the fact that, like, the headset was no longer on his ear. Yes, it was in the middle of his forehead.
Skewed. Yeah.
Yeah. Just to give that sense of crashing.
Yep. But, yeah, it does, you know, the wholesale... The
foam rubber the foam wholesalers. Rubber
wholesalers convention.
Foam rubber in its crude form. What goes up white and comes down yellow and white? An egg. How do you divide 17 apples among 16 people? Make applesauce. I just...
Yeah. And how do they get that into, you know, a unification in eggs perfect container?
The container of all our hopes and futures. That is the most... That led them to the United World Organization. Oh, I love this.
Now, this coming up is a scene I do remember. And I remember laughing then, and I'm laughing now, where it's faster for them to run across town than to take a taxi. Because they're in such perfect shape.
That's funny. I do like that sub.
Yeah. And instead of a propeller at the end, it's got the flippers. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and again, they've got a great plan. They're sneaking into the secret decommissioned submarine exit, which okay.
The Joker's really cool in this, too. One of the pieces, it's the physicality of Cesar Romero in this, which I thought was really great. You know, the way that he, like, prances and stuff, I thought was just really, really cool.
Oh, definitely. He has, again, he has fun with it. You see him, all of them have fun with the physical side of it.
They really did do a good job with sets of this, because obviously they were using a model for the actual sub itself, but making sure that we got to see different elements.
One of the things I thought was kind of neat right here was the cat burglar is the one who figures out where to break in.
Yeah.
Uses her cat to find the weakness in the door where they can plant the explosive. You know, it's little subtle stuff like that, again, really added to my enjoyment on watching this.
Well, they had blueprints. That was how they knew where that door was. Like, there was, the story really had, like, some depth to explaining things. Even the silly explanations had a logic planned out to them. Yeah, I mean, as much as a bat logic, if you will.
Yeah. Now, Penguin's gas is one of the ones that does crack me up. Just how, you know,
it goes over him more than everybody else.
Yes. And it doesn't affect him.
Right. Well, because he's got the pills, the anti-penguin gas pills too, apparently.
The physical humor that they got going on does crack me up with this.
It's really well done.
Yes.
Yeah. His moves are good too. His waddle that he does was great.
The little subtle thing with the guards who are leaning on each other, and then he pushes them, they go back falling together, you know, holding each other up. It does crack me up. The physical comedy.
I like that they all think that, once again, the dynamic duo, of course, has been silenced forever because it finally worked.
Yes, they finally got him. You know, but again, they admit, hey, it was an accident, but we'll take it.
So funny. I like that they all need to inhale. In the meantime, the penguin, he's probably, like, loaded with that gas now.
Yes. You know, and again, neat little thing. They all, on the same time, and ran through there. Is like, now, this United Nations or United Security Council or whatever.
Yeah.
One of the things I loved about this was just how the entire time they're just all arguing.
Right. Like,
if you listen carefully, they're all trying to argue for peace. So they're all yelling about peace.
I like this whole idea, Stitch in Time saves nine, the nine members of the council. It's like, some of the jokes are just, oh.
Yeah.
They're like the appropriate kind of groany.
Oh, God. Oh, God, yeah. And now, why didn't anybody from the security council see these four walk in?
Because they were in the middle of an intense argument.
Someone walks in the room, you notice, especially someone that looks like them.
Not when you're that passionate about your argument.
Now, when the first one disappears, I think that's what I would notice. But I love how they don't at all. They just keep doing their thing, and it's, you know.
Wait, here's the thing. To your point. What about the people across the table on the other side watching all this?
Yeah. Oh, God, it's just absolutely brilliant.
That's great.
Now, one question I do have, why didn't Batman and Robin call ahead and tell them, hey, the security council's in danger?
Why is their dust all different colors?
Because they're different people.
But that's not the case with, like, the guinea pigs.
Well, because they were the guinea pigs. They're all the same guy.
So funny. Be sure to gather all of them. Why?
Because they need all the pieces.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah. And again, the up. Okay, that button.
I like that he knew what it said, though. Why did you have to go? Why did you have to go all the way across, though?
Yeah.
So funny.
And oh, what a surprise. They're still alive.
One false move and you'll find out we'll hurl our batarangs. Now this is a funny bit. Because Catwoman basically stops him with, I don't think you mean that, Batman. Miss Kitka dies if you take one more step. Then he takes like 80 steps.
Yes.
Like right here. At what point in time is that okay?
Well, because they already made it to the elevator. Got
it. Oh, this is the discovery of the Security Council. What a fiendishly clever way to abduct nine. I mean, geez.
Yes. And it's funny, Robin was a little surprised when he ran in there. What did he think they were doing?
I love that they know exactly where they're going. I actually really did like this part of the show because of the fact that they're analyzing the situation together. Robin adds something to it, certainly. The two of them are analyzing clues. The detective work in this is a pretty fluid thing. Even though it's crazy logic, it's still logic. Sort of.
Yeah, kind of. Now, I do like how their plan here. Again, the villains have a plan. You know, they've got them all captured. They're going to ransom out send out ransom messages. And here's where they really break Riddler. Make it a straightforward, no stupid riddles.
Yeah, yeah.
Make the messages plain. $1 billion cash from each country. Now, the United States' answer would be, we do not negotiate with terrorists. We're not taking back our security person. There's no way they would pay $1.50, much less $1 billion.
Listen, this is a well-thought-out plan. They know how to negotiate.
Yeah.
I love that bat boat.
Yes.
That thing just cruising across the water.
That boat does look cool.
That is really awesome.
Yeah.
As much as I love the Batmobile, I love the boat more. It just looks really cool.
Yeah, see, and with my brother Dave has his retirement home is on a lake community. I'd love to have that bat boat, for his for driving around Lake Mohawk. That'd be hysterical.
Well, if you can just find out where they parked it, they seem to just leave it everywhere.
They just leave it there with the keys and the ignition, so yeah. Hey. Now, again, weaponries, they're trying to take out the bat, they've got the thing. Now, this sequence when, every time Riddler just does that, runs up the line there, that does look pretty cool. I like that.
Yeah. The surface-to-surface homing missile?
Yes. And they're using the same footage, but that's okay.
Yeah, it's working for all the... those parts are working.
Oh, big time. And I liked how, Bruce, did his homework on the missile. Because he'd already seen it a couple times, so he knew to prepare for it.
This Batman was sly. I did like those aspects of it.
This is a Batman who does prepare.
Yeah.
We're seeing the detective, we're seeing the physical side, we're seeing the guy who's everything's ready. This is the Batman who gave the comic book Batman his utility belt, which had the Bat Shark Rebellion in it. So, this guy's good to go.
I'm anxiously awaiting for this payoff of this missile.
Yeah.
I love it without seeing it. Like, here's the thing. From now on, unless I've seen verification, I am not assuming anything.
Right. And they're dancing. And again, small craft still closing. Range 4,000.
They almost are the antithesis of, like, Batman in this, where how many times in the comics have we seen where it looks like the villain was dead? And that, like, more than likely the villain escaped. This has got that same vibe to it.
Yes.
Except the reverse.
Now, the bat charge, the bat depth charger, bat charger launcher, whatnot, whatever you're going to do with it, that was the thing that got me, because I was thinking immediately what we kind of see start to happen. Do you really want to rock the boat?
Right.
And again, as they got him into sights, they're waiting. No, fire. Come on.
The sub is cool. Their sub, it really is cool.
Yes. Oh, God, yeah. It's a good villain. It's a good villain, vehicle and whatnot.
This was a toy I wouldn't have minded owning.
Yes. And this time I like the fact that they fired more than one torpedo as well.
Well, showing an escalation, right?
Yes. They learn from the past. They can take out one torpedo, so let's send two at them.
Yeah.
You know, and a neat little thing that I liked on this was, you know, with him using the stopwatch to determine, you know, the explosion happened too soon. You know, because I'll be honest with you, in modern Navy, time, you know, and all that is a big part of navigation.
It must be bat charges. Yes. And that means there'll be more of those dreadful things for us. How does, like, bat charges, like they carry them in stores?
Yes.
I love the way this stuff is discussed.
Yeah. But here's a neat thing. There's some actual sound naval tactics here.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I thought that was a really cool part of that. Again, I had no memory of and didn't realize it going on, but the diving down, running deep, running silent, that's a standard on the sub usages.
He's trying to play real time. He's trying to play real life battleship with Batman.
Yes.
I'm sorry, though, but you were saying about using the time and everything like that, which is...
Again, that's actually really used in underwater navigations by modern submarines. You know, it's, you know, the knowing your speed, knowing the charts, knowing how long, you know, you travel, and it's a time thing. It's actually been used in the modern Navy. I think that was something that I saw. I was like, oh, that's kind of cool.
Sometimes you just want to read a book.
Yes, you're reading a book while the boat you're on, which he doesn't realize he's on a submarine, is rocking all over the place.
I love the sliding bodies of the nine council members.
You know, and again, this year's where I was laughing, going, Batman, Robin, you may not want to do that.
So funny.
But again, you understand what they're doing, though. They're getting them to surface. And that's actually what depth charges are designed to do on subs, because when they detonate underwater, the concussion and the shockwave, you don't actually have to hit the sub
to
affect it. So again, modern, actual true tactics being used. It did crack me up.
Oh, yeah.
Now, it's funny how in these sequences, Joker is the rational one.
He is kind of like, he takes kind of like the lead role.
You know, you want to live forever, you know? You know? And it's to the Joker who's like, you know, forget you. He's the one who orders the emergency, blow the ballast, you know, surface, you know?
Which is what Batman was counting on, though. They were counting on them eventually to need to surface.
Yeah, but I love how it's the Joker who's the rational one.
This is so well done.
Yes. Oh, God, yeah. Absolutely love this. And again, these are all sequences I had no memory of at all. So when I was watching it last night, it was like the first time watching it. I was like, oh, this is kind of cool. What happens now?
I remembered the bat charges when I saw them, but if you'd asked me before watching it again, I wouldn't have remembered it.
Yeah. Again, this whole, all these sequences I completely forgot about. You know, and again, I like the approach. I like just this upcoming fight sequence, man, I thought was absolutely wonderful. They did some really cool fight sequences. Nothing as, no graphic, no over-the-top violence, but still had plenty of action, you know, for you to enjoy it.
Yeah, yeah. And that's something that was, they were trying to, you know, they're trying to put good comic book combat into this. You know, because this was meant to be that kind of parody of that type of thing. And they had, like, giant wrenches and stuff like that that people were throwing around.
Yep.
I always liked these because there's, it showed some teamwork between Batman and Robin and some genuine need for both of them in a fight.
Oh, God, yeah. You know, and even when the villains start getting into, you know, the play, and it's not just the thugs. You know, it's really cool watching them go. Now, it's funny seeing, because Burt Ward did that one little move to the top part, but I don't know how much more of it's him and how much is a stuntman. So they did a pretty good job of blending the actors and the stuntmen.
I did like when we glossed over this, the Penguin, and I'm sorry, the Joker knocks out Riddler. Or,
yeah.
That was kind of cool.
Now, when Catwoman throws the cat at Batman, is she expecting the cat to do anything to Batman?
Besides provide a distraction? I don't know.
Okay.
It's pretty crazy. It certainly led to a certain bit.
Well, it's funny bit because he's, you know, he can't hurt a little kitty cat, you know, so he's fighting with one arm. So it did a pretty good job.
Do you think she knew that was going to happen?
Maybe.
I'm trying to figure out the logic of this.
You know, throws a little cat in the safety thing, you know.
So funny.
And again, more great tag team with Batman and Robin. It's really cool seeing this. And, you know, it's funny. Everyone's going into the water. Everyone's going into the water. And, it, you know, I'm just sitting there watching one. Okay, when is everybody going to go into the water? Because, you know, it's going to happen.
Catwoman was really good in this. She really did a good job. For the era.
Well, again, yeah, she's the one who knocks Robin in. I think she even gives a push and takes out Batman, gets Batman in the water.
Yeah, she was sticking and moving. It was a good move.
She got both of the dynamic duo in the water.
It almost looks like Star Trek IV.
Yeah. And it, seeing how much of it's stunt doubles, how much of it is the actual actors, you know, did crack me up. You know, and I liked how they tied up. They ended up using the rope that was there to tie up the bad guys. But then, the moment we all waited for, he finds out Catwoman is Mitkika. I loved this sequence, man. Holy heartbreak.
That was great. I did like the movies and the TV show seemed to play off of when different actors were playing Catwoman.
Yeah. Yeah, feel bad for Bruce.
I like that Robin, you know, he's telling Robin, you know, you kind of got to take on the role. And Robin took one, like, for to basically understand, hey, Bruce is having some trouble with this right now. Let me try to help him out.
Yeah.
He really was a good partner in this.
Say no more, Robin. It would be compromising. Once again, almost slips.
But it was good that, like, I like the attention to detail. You got to protect the secret identity. I thought that was really cool.
Oh, God, yeah. I'm not knocking any of this. I like this. Yeah. I thought this was kind of cool.
Yeah, no, I wasn't saying you were. I thought it was just, you know, adding on to what you were saying. I thought that attention to detail was just awesome.
Yeah. Now, the funny thing is, I remember what's coming up. But I didn't remember how it happened.
Oh, with
Gary. Yeah, with the council being knocked over and their ashes getting mixed up. I remember that. But I didn't remember the Commodore until we see him walk in the room. And I'm like, oh, I know what's going to happen.
That part is so great. The hope of the entire world tottering on the brink.
Holy, almost.
I do like the idea that, like, this is an era where peace talks and things like that were, you know, pretty critical.
Yeah. Oh. He trips. Oh, no. And then he sneezes.
I'd be checking his fingerprints to make sure he's not the Penguin.
Yeah. Now, here's the thing. I remember all of this stuff going on, going from here forward. I remember this. I remember the ending. You know, and but it's funny. I don't remember.
Here's why you remember it. Because in your garage, you too have a super molecular dust separator.
Well, I don't remember the medical robes or any of that stuff. I remember them going through and separating them and the anticipation of, oh no, can they do it? But it did crack me up that they had to wear robe, that they had to put on their medical garb.
Bat medical garb.
Well, but it doesn't have the little bat logo on it. It should have a bat logo.
It's on the inside of the pocket.
Oh, okay.
It's still bat. You got to prove me otherwise.
I'm not going to argue with you.
I love the president of this.
Yeah. That was actually a pretty good LBJ.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and it's funny, the Aunt Harriet Harriet, is it?
Yeah.
I don't remember ever seeing her episodes with her, to be honest with you.
She was in almost every one, if not every one.
I don't remember her at all.
Because she was the reason why Robin was there. It's Robin's okay. Aunt Harriet.
Oh, okay.
Neil Hamilton was great as Commissioner Gordon. I don't know if we mentioned his name before, but he really was just a stellar actor in this.
And he's not as incompetent as I always remembered him as being really incompetent.
Really?
And he's really not. Yeah. And this portrayal is not that incompetent. You know, and that was always something when the 89 Batman came out and this and that, I was happy that Commissioner Gordon wasn't as incompetent as I remembered this guy being, but I falsely was remembering.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Cause I think they do a nice job with him of,
yeah. You know, Batman has his role, you know, as a deputy agent, and the police have their role. So it's kind of like, you know, they work together. It's they do keep the Gordon Batman relationship just a little bit different.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree.
Though per current standards of wearing a mask, Batman is wrong. His nose was not covered.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
You know, we've all been taught that now.
It's a perfect opportunity to have Batman teach us that.
I know. A separation is complete, you know. You know, and then they announce it out to the world. And, you know, it's funny. These sequences, did they really need these sequences? Probably not. But, again, it fits the show and it fits the movie. And I was like, I didn't have a problem with it. And it did crack me up that they did this, you know, with the different countries in the world. And, you know, they tried to, they showed us those different countries by the way they were standing around and their clothes and whatnot. I think it did what it was supposed to do. So, you know, while I initially would say it's not needed, I'm glad they have it in there. You know, and just the meticulousness that they're doing, the hydrator, you know, if you want, I don't know which would be proper terminology, but just how meticulous they are being about this. And they're taking their time with it, you know. And again, it's something that they could have done the scene a lot faster, but it kind of fits nicely. I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. You know, adding to the drama of what's going to happen next. Oh, no. Can Batman do this? Can the Caped Crusaders successfully rehydrate these people?
The anticipation of this was great because I just kept wondering what was going to happen. Even this time around, you're like, where I've seen this before, I'm like, is there a twist to this? What ends up happening? I remember Batman was successful, but I mean, put quotes around successful.
It was funny because I remember all this stuff playing out. I remember the twist at the end.
Yeah.
You know, but there is a scene I forgot about, you know, So, and I liked, again, the second watching, knowing through and just knowing what I know, the build up to this, you know, and it, again, it's, you know, ready to rehydrate. Just the seriousness and the look of concern on Burt Ward's face is absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
He really did a great job as Robin. I've never given him enough credit for the acting that he did as Robin.
He sets up a lot of stuff for Batman.
Yeah.
They really did great casting on this.
Yes. Oh God, yeah. You know, and again, as you said, the commissioner and the chief.
Chief O'Hara.
O'Hara. I always, in my head, I always remember them as more goofy and campy and, you know, not actually real cops. You know, but watching this, I'm like, okay, I can see. I'm like, okay, they actually did a pretty good job with them.
Stafford Rep played Chief O'Hara, too, which is cool.
You know, they're like, success. And it's funny because immediately as the politicians come back, they immediately go back to yelling at each other. There's no, hey, what just happened? You know, none of that. There is, oh, we got to keep yelling and arguing because we're politicians, you know. And I'm like, oh, God. You know, and then the realization that they're speaking different languages. I love that. You know, yeah. And I remember that happening, you know, and just seeing this play out and how, you know, how they're each now speaking in a different language and they mixed up their bodies and whatnot. And, you know, just the ramifications of what could possibly this could mean for the world.
The actors playing them did a good job because they had to keep this idea of, we were in the middle of this passionate fight. We are coming back to this passionate fight. We don't even notice what's happening.
Yes. Not yet. And yeah, how would they not notice they're not speaking the wrong language?
Well, who knows? I think what we don't know is what other changes are there.
True.
I'm not disagreeing with you, by the way. Yes to everything you just said. I'm more adding to that and going, and how would they not know that? You know what I mean? It's one of those things. But I like Batman's kind of like, hey, let's go inconspicuously through the window. We use our bat ropes.
Yeah, I'm laughing because they're like, whoops, we just messed up here. Let's sneak out. All we need is them whistling.
Maybe what nobody will notice that it was us.
Yeah, whoops. Because we don't get a lot of the bat climbs. And we only got the one scene where it was really a big bat climb. And that was always a big piece of the TV show because celebrities wanted to be the person that Batman walked past the window on.
Yep. So good.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And again, another great scene for the stuntmen to do. Sliding down a rope down the building. The stuntmen must have had a ball filming this movie.
Oh, yeah, I would agree. This was not meant them like seeing them almost rappel down. I mean, they're sliding down on the bat rope versus. Yeah. Really
now, part of me does wonder if that's actually people or if they did mannequins.
Well, because they used them quite a bit in this, didn't they? Like dummies. Yeah. I mean, we saw sequences where they used dummies in it. So, overall thoughts. Like, one of the things I've been doing gradually, and it's been due to time. I've been every so often watching an episode or two of the TV series that led to this. It's something that's interesting. Is this like something that you would rewatch? Like now, having seen it now, understanding what it is this, I mean, we obviously did it for the show for nostalgia purposes. Our nostalgia is different for this. And certainly my viewing of it was different in the sense that I was enjoying much more the camp and comedy of the story than, you know, reliving my childhood so much on this one. There are certain episodes of the TV show that spark something in me. There's a two-parter with Catwoman in particular that I had the Viewmasters of that I vividly remember because of the Viewmasters. But is this something like you did watch it as a kid, but clearly it didn't have, with your lack of remembering of it, it didn't have the impact on you as maybe some other things. Where are you at right now with this series and, like, what you would do with it?
I'm rewatching the series.
Are you?
Yeah, this 100% got me thinking I want to rewatch this whole series.
Yeah.
You know, and because, again, I got to see, you know, as I said, I don't remember Aunt Harriet, you know, and I want to see that. And I don't think I have no memory at all of episode one.
Episode one is cool. Like, there's,
I have no memory of that.
There's some,
so
like,
I want to watch episode one. And just like I want to go back and the Shazam. I want to rewatch this, the Shazam TV show. Yeah, because again, Bill told me that we watched that one religiously, and I have zero memory of it other than a vague Winnebago. I remember vaguely the Winnebago, and he used to have meetings with the council, with the different gods, and they would show him sometimes, but I have no recollection of that show, so I want to watch that show. So this is something that's gotten me wanting to watch all those stuff.
Episode one of the 66 show in particular has like this mantle sequence with Bruce Wayne where he's reminiscing about the death of his parents. And I'm not going to say anything else about it other than if you're somebody listening, you haven't watched that. It's a really cool sequence that follows comic book lore really strongly. And it was surprisingly really serious.
Cool.
It kind of lays out his motivation for being Batman. And I really appreciated it early on, seeing like the Adam West version approach it that way. It was cool. So this was great. I was really, really worth it. So would you recommend somebody watch this, Jim? And who and how? Like, what would you do? Because to me, the interesting part right now is obviously everybody listening to this was following along because either they already owned it, they wanted to join us in the, you know, the 700 show, things like that. But like for a casual audience right now, and you know, because you and I both talk to people who aren't like diehards like you and I are per se. Who would you recommend this to somebody, and how would you prep them if you would? How would you prep them for what they're going to see?
I actually would recommend this to the comic book fan. You know, the people, because I got a couple of people at work who are, they're fans of the comic book genre. They've never read a comic book. They're never going to read a comic book. Mm-hmm. But they watch the movies. They watch the TV shows sometimes. They're more movie watchers.
Got it.
And this is something I would, you know, tell them, like, hey, there's this movie about, it's from the Batman 66. You know, you got to preface it so they got to know there's going to be heavy camp. It's from the 66, you know, series. It's, you know, there's some goofy stuff in there, but embrace the goofiness. Now, I got some friends who I think would 100% love it. I've got other people who I don't think I would recommend it to them just because I can't see them going into the camp. The people who like the airplane movies, if you like airplane movies, you're going to probably enjoy this. Now, if you like the goofy, you know, what was that one, God, it had Val Kilmer in it. It was a spy.
Oh, Top Secret.
Thank you.
Yeah, Top Secret is one of my favorite movies from Zucker, yeah. Abram Zucker. Yeah, really good one.
If you watch that and enjoyed that movie, you'd probably enjoy this.
Yeah.
You have to have that sense of humor to, you know, to enjoy this kind of movie.
Real genius, stuff like that. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Very much silly comedies. You know, silly with a story, but silly with a story. That's what it is. Yeah, this had a good story.
That's the thing that did shock me the most about this, was how much of a story there was with this. And again, how much this was true to Batman, Robin, the Commissioner, even all the villains. They had those kind of, again, it takes it to another level of goofiness, but it still was solid with it. You think back to the third Batman, you know, with Tommy Lee Jones and
Jim Carrey.
Jim Carrey. Those really annoyed me just because they lost the groove of who those characters were to me. You know, there was potential, but they kind of took it over the top, you know. And then the movies after, they kept taking it over and over and over, you know, with, you know, later on with the next movie with Schwarzenegger as Mr. Freeze and, of course, Veggie Man. You know, instead of Bane, you know, those kind of stuff, those annoyed me more than this portrayal.
Well, they get this right. Villains. I mean, they really do get thematically the characters right.
Right.
You know, it's definitely camp, but thematically they got the characters right on this, which I think really works. And that was something that stood out for me too, because I guess I was kind of wondering, you know, I've been watching the show for a while now. I was wondering how, and I've gotten used to the theme again of the 20-something minutes of story, and then you get the cliffhanger, and then you go on to the next one. I actually enjoy the formula and everything they're doing. I was wondering how much I would enjoy this extended hour and 45 minutes again, because it's been a while since I've seen it. And it's really, really was fun. You mentioned other movies that people who I would recommend it to. If you liked Austin Powers, I would say, why, and you know, this is your thing. And I would, you know, for something a little more contemporary, the three Austin Powers movies. Was there three of those? Did I have that right?
I think there's three of them.
Yeah. I don't. Well, there was, I guess I was more questioning if there's more than three, but I'm almost positive there was three of them. But those Austin Powers movies, certainly anybody enjoying and watching those would certainly enjoy this. So, you know, it's got that thing, but you got to walk in knowing that's what you're getting.
Yes.
So it was good. Well, buddy, thank you for doing this one. Thank you to your brother Bill, too, for suggesting it, because it was nice to... This was reliving a piece of my childhood, and it was funny to watch it from an adult perspective and really enjoying it for how it was intended to be viewed by adults, at least. It's funny how this really adapts very nicely to different audiences. And, boy, this very much, if you were to ask me who my Batman is, this is my Batman. I grew up with loving this guy, idolizing him, and I will always have a soft spot in my heart for this Batman.
Holy caffeine!
I would like to remind everyone about our show voicemail line. It's 1-440-388-4434 or Dr. Norge on Skype. RagingBullets@gmail.com is our email address if you prefer to contact us that way. RagingBullets.com is our show website. It feeds into our Facebook fan page. It also feeds into Twitter. We are proud to be part of an amazing Facebook group community, and we regularly pull Speeding Bullets segments right from that community. They go there regularly, and they curate not only great DC news, but fun memes. They link to podcasts. They link to just commentary about various things that are comic-related, both inside and outside of the DC universe. If you're a blogger and a podcaster, please feel free, you know, to shout out things that are going on that you think will be relevant to our audience, whether it's inside or outside of DC. I'm very, very lucky in the sense that, and Jim's very lucky, Raging Bullets is very lucky, that over the years we just had people that have just been kind enough to shout us out and make people aware that we exist. Please use us, whether you're calling into the show or using our communities as a way to shout out things that you're doing. This is a collaborative environment. We're very, very lucky to be a part of it. I'd be remiss if I didn't shout out on this episode. Just over the years, we're 700 episodes in. We have been very lucky with, you know, I always reference Peter Rios over at Comic Geek Speak, but the Comic Geek Speak community has always been very accepting of us and very good at shouting us out. So many fellow podcasters that please, I'm not going to be able to shout out everybody over the years who have become genuine friends, who have supported the show, been on the show. I've been on their shows. And there's people who maybe I'm not aware of that have shouted us out, and I apologize. I'm hoping we get to directly interact. Ian Levenstein, he did a show called Geek Speak back in the day when, before we started Raging Bullets, was kind enough to have me on. He was a major catalyst in getting the show going. So many podcasters, though, right when we were getting started, who were kind enough to reach out with suggestions, advice, and helping the show get going. And I just want to thank everybody from the podcast community. We've been very lucky over the 700 episodes that we've done on this show to have some great creators on. We are not an interview podcast. And what I mean is, it's not that we've shied away from it. Early on, we did. And the thinking behind that was because we tend to talk about things that we're enthusiastic about talking about. We didn't want to come off as disingenuous as, oh, they're only doing that to get people on the show. No, we just pick things that we're interested in talking about. We've never made like an edict on the show that, geez, everything needs to be positive. It's just kind of turned out that way. Neither of us is afraid to say, hey, I don't like this. There's been times on the show where we have. It's just not a big focus on the podcast. And in truth, I think I'm part of the reason for that, in the sense that that's not how I approach comics. I know what I want to read, and I'm usually excited to read it. It's my escape from other things in my life. And I think we're that kind of voice. Jim's you're that person too, you know, as far as I think we both approach comics that way, but our debates usually are with each other. If there are things we don't like or things we maybe take issue or with, it's this insane debates that you and I have had over these years, which brings me to you. The original intention of this show was I was going to do a rotating cast of characters, mainly because I didn't think anybody would want to jump on board this crazy train. And I couldn't have predicted that when we started this, I thought it was going to be a few months of doing this as an experiment of, hey, let me do a short little thing where we figure out my friends who are non-readers, what they might be interested in. Would they become readers? I did the first episode with you and it just felt great. And I reached out to you and I've referenced this on the show over the years a number of times. You were that friend that I just knew that, like, if I asked Jim to do this, Jim's going to say yes. Just because you're the guy that's always there. And you've always been that friend for me, you know, where I knew I could count on you. And you've always just been willing to be there. And I appreciate that about you. You're just that guy. You're just reliable. You're always there as a friend, whether it's to be there in person, whether it's just for advice. You know, over the years, you and I became friends a lot more in college, and especially afterwards. I really appreciate you and your loyalty and all of those pieces. I couldn't do this podcast without you. And so just thank you for 700 episodes. I could never have predicted that not only would we hit 700, but there'd be no signs of stopping. You know, I really I look forward to doing this with you because it's an opportunity to do this with you. It's so great that we have an audience that appreciate the audience, that they find some value in listening to this banter between the two of us. But thank you. I couldn't do this without you.
The other day I played a game with myself, what if? And I started looking at what if I didn't do this? What if I didn't do that? And some of the times the what if really took a very dark and nasty path, you know, and it's on multiple things. And it was funny when I got to the what if I hadn't done Raging Bullets? You know, what if I had, you know, if I'd only done the one episode and never did anything else or even told you, I'm kind of busy right now, I can't. What if that had happened? And I started looking at all the different things I've done and just the, you know, the areas in my life that this show has helped me through. There have been so many times just the work, life, and everything was just beating on me that this show got me through it, that these comics got me through this. So when I started doing the what if game about Raging Bullets, man, I'll tell you right now, if this show never happened, I would be a much different person. And I really like who I am now. I really like being the comic book geek that some of my, you know, peers see me as. I don't care. I like who I am. You know, and I like doing this. I have fun when we record. I have fun reading my comics, going to movies, doing the different stuff. You know, this is one of those things that this really helped me through a lot of my life. So to you, Sean, thank you. I've said multiple times, and I'm going to always keep saying thank you to you for this show and to the people who listen and, you know, to the people, you know, the people who put up with some of my nonsense, who put up with some of the crazy stuff I do, some of you who really enjoy it. Thank you. It's, you know, this is something that my life would be worse off. I know 100% without this. So I am very happy and grateful that I have this opportunity. And 700 down, here comes 1,000. I want episode 1,000 now.
I want to say to our listening audience, too, you know, as we talk about that piece, and I don't say this lightly, we're an interesting show. We're a very niche show, and I'm very well aware of that. To be a niche show and be around for this many episodes is because we have an audience base. You have given us time over the years. Some of you, you know, it's you're newer to the show. Some people have been hit and run in the sense that life just makes it hard to listen to multiple podcasts. And, you know, sometimes the niche podcast is the one that you kind of like set aside for a while. But there's people who listen to episodes based on interest. Whether you listen to every single minute of every show that we do or enjoy certain segments, I appreciate that you give us the time. I have over the years seen people who recommend us on Twitter, on Facebook, on Instagram, wherever, in forums, in all kinds of other areas. Please know for us, that is such an important thing that you do. If you get point us to one person, one more person, It helps just people be aware of this. And that's motivation for us as podcasters, to be honest, to see that your audience numbers are rising or staying steady even when you are doing something that's a little engine that could like this. So thank you over the years. There have been people like Eli, for example, who's contributed to our new opening theme and our closing theme that we have right now. There have been people that have created dedicated artwork and stuff that you'll see on our websites and continue to send us things. Please feel free to share your creativity and add it to the show. It's something that it makes this a community show, and please know we feel that. You know, yes, this is Jim and I doing a lot of gabbing and talking about comics, but this is always about all of us. If you've called into the show, if you've sent us things, anything that you've done over the years, even, you know, and even just if all you can do is listen, that means a lot. We see your vote of confidence in us by the fact that you downloaded the episode, and it means something. That's why people continue to do this. This is not a moneymaker for us. We're lucky that we have a sponsor like DCB Service that helps keep the lights on, but this doing a podcast, a niche podcast in particular, and that isn't just us, I would say all niche podcasts. There's a lot of different ways that people try to fund their podcast to break even and perhaps make a little bit to make it worthwhile doing it. For us, this show has never been a moneymaker. We don't actively seek out sponsors just because, I don't know, I'm here to have fun, chat with you guys about comics. And I mean, that's really what this is about. Thank you for being here, because Jim and I can have these conversations. We like to chat and hang out together and don't get to do it in person as much. Gives us kind of the outlet to hang out together. You provide that reason why. We're doing it for you. So thank you for giving us your time, because you've given us a lot over the years. We've done a lot of gabbing on this show. And thank you for finding that of value. Any participation that you've done beyond that from our great team who's taken really control of the Facebook group community, to people who have been participating through voicemails and other pieces, just thank you. It just means a lot. If you've guested on the show, thank you for contributing in that way. Writers, artists, you know, who have been willing to take the leap to trust us by being on this podcast is something that has meant a lot over the years, because that's a level of trust too, trusting that we're going to protect them. This has been a great experience. And you're right, Jim. I can't wait to, we're all eyes are on 1,000. I think we got to get over the hump of 800 first, though. So off we go to the next stage in this. And thank you for joining us for this. We are sponsored. Speaking of sponsors that help keep the lights on, and they really, really do. They sponsor a lot of podcasts, and Raging Bullets is one of them. DCB Service and InStockTrades.com. Jim, what is going on over at DCBService.com? Because they're just such a great company.
Well, we've got the DC Hero Clicks Iconics, the Nightfall scene, Bane breaking the bat, 25% off, $22.49, and the Batman and Robin slap meme, 25% off, only $14.99. Thank you, DCBS.
Over at InStockTrades.com, we have the Batman One Bad Day box set, direct market edition. This is a very cool way to get this. $44.99 regularly, 50% off, only $22.49. The Batman 89 movie adaptation trade paperback, Danny O'Neill, Jerry Ordway, $14.99 regularly, 50% off, only $7.49. The Unwritten Compendium Number 1. Such a great, great book. Mike Carey, Peter Gross, $59.99 regularly, 50% off, only $29.99. I want to thank DCB Service and InStockTrades.com for continuing to support our show. Our next episode, Jim and I are going to be back, and we're going to be talking about Wonder Woman 800. We will see you then.
Bye.
All right, you guys. Are you ready to sing your song?
I can be on. Yeah, let's sing it now.
Okay, this should be fun. Now get ready for your cue. Okay, Sean?
Okay.
Okay, Jim? Jim? Jim!
Okay. Raging Bullets time is here. We talk about what we hold dear. Comic books and TV shows. We talk about the books
Okay, fellas, get ready. That was very good, Sean.
Naturally.
Jim, you're a little flat there, so be careful. Jim? Jim? Jim!
Okay. Justice League and so much more. I still love Green Lantern Corps. DC Comics are what we know. The Raging Bullet Show. DC Comics are what we know. The Raging Bullet Show.
Excellent job, guys.
Let's sing it again. Yeah, let's sing it again.
No, that's enough. Let's not push it.
Push it? What is that? Yeah, what are you talking about?
No, I didn't mean anything by that.
I didn't mean anything by that.
Jim, how long do you want the song to go?
Look, it's our production.